Okay, welcome to grade 12, applied. Let's check the volume here, that's good. 27 Feb, it's day one. Day one, first day, grade 12 applied, course overview. Right, so here's what we're going to learn. Now this is all new course for me. The curriculum changed and we implemented it just this year. So there's new stuff that I still have to prepare. So yeah, you're going to have to attend class because I don't have all kinds of extra supports for this. So here's the, and then we'll do a course overview, and then we'll start with Unit A, probability. Everybody loves probability. In fact, they do it every day. So I actually combine probability with the permutations and combinations unit. Let's have a look at what we're going to learn. So there's the things we're going to learn right there. Let's talk about them. Let's talk about them again. All right, so guess what? You're going to learn about probability. What's the probability if you found a family with three girls? What's the probability if you got three kids that all three will be girls? Because what Melissa was saying, she's got a friend that has five girls. Yeah, I do too. All right. Turns out there's only a 1 in 32 chance that you'll have five girls. It's possible to have 10 girls in a row. I saw a family that did that in a book. Right? That's 1 in 1,024 chance, by the way. But anyway, what's the probability if you had a family of three that they got all three girls? Well, you could build a little tree like this. Right? Girl, 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 boy. You could do all the possible outcomes. There's your first baby, your second baby, your third baby. Right? So you could say girl, 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 boy, girl, girl, etc. And there'd be eight branches to that tree. And of course, how many of those branches have three girls? Well, only one branch has three girls, and each one of those branches is equally likely. So there's a 1 out of 8 chance that you'll have all girls. Yeah, so we're going to learn how to calculate stuff like that. Turns out you're more likely to have two girls and one boy, or two boys and one girl, which, funny enough, happens to be the same thing. All right. Then we're going to do some personal finance. You know, how much money do you spend when you buy a $200,000 house, if you can even find one? Turns out that you probably spend about 2.5 times as much. So a $200,000 house will probably cost you $500,000 if you pay for it over 25 years. All right, so we'll learn about financial decisions, rent versus buy, loans, taxes, house buying, all that fun stuff. All right, do you buy or do you rent or whatever? All right, how about functions? We're going to learn about functions. This is a new unit as well. So you have functions all month long, all week long. Things depend on other things. That's what a function is. Your mood is a function of the day of the month, maybe. All right. So there you go. You might start out, this could be Mel. She starts out there, and then she gets a bit grumpy, and then she gets happy, and oh yeah, and then right by the end of the month, she's really super happy because she loves her math or something. All right. So, but how about somebody's bank account, right? That could be somebody's bank account in blue, right? They got some money, they spend it, they're down to zero for a couple days, and then they got money, and then they spend it. So guess what? Your bank account is a function of the day of the month. I know mine is. I mean, I remember the good old days, you know, no money, one box of Kraft dinner for 2 days. Yeah, I miss those days. So we're going to talk about things that depend on other things, your mood compared to the day. How much money you got depend on the day. Everything you do depends on something else. Well, usually more than one thing. All right, there you go. We're going to look at logic. All right. So if I said everyone with brown eyes is cute. All right. Now this is an important unit, and hopefully we get a chance to actually do it. If I said everyone with brown eyes is cute, does that mean that all non-cute people, I didn't say ugly, all non-cute people don't have brown eyes? You know what? People do that all the time. Politicians will smoke this by all the time. They'll say, everyone that's smart votes for me. And then they'll say, and that means if you're not smart, you won't vote for me. That's not the same thing. Right? That's called a contrapositive. Just because you turn it around and make it negative doesn't mean it's still true. Oh, yeah, so learning a bit of logic will help you trip people up who try to smoke some stuff by you, and they'll try to convince you with false logic of things. Politicians are good at that. All right, and they don't even have to learn it. They're just naturally good at it. All right, let's learn permutations and combinations. We'll do this. We'll combine this with the probability unit. So when we're doing Unit A, we're actually doing Unit E as well. So there's some Mingo Dabbers. So you're off to Bingo, right? You got your Lucky Troll, you got a Green Dabber, a Blue Dabber, and a Yellow Dabber. And you sit down and you go, how many ways can I line up those three Bingo Dabbers in a line in front of me? Three different Bingo Dabbers, line them up. Let's see. No, not 10 ways. We're trying to figure out how many arrangements we can make of our Bingo Dabbers. How many can we make? Let's see. Arrange them. How many ways? Somebody said 5. No. Somebody said 12. No. Somebody said 9. No. How about 7? No. It turns out here's how you do it. Look at this. Pretend you're going to set them down in front of you. You got three places to set them down. How many choices for the first spot? How many choices do you have when you put something on the first spot in your lineup? Aren't there three? Sure. So you got three choices. So it's three choices. And how many choices for the second spot? Well, it's two, isn't it? Because you can't pick the one you put there because you can't use it again because you've already put it down. So now you got two choices. So now you've put one of your dabbers there and one of your dabbers there. So how many choices do you have for there? Right? Well, some people would say you got no choice. But you know what? In math, one choice is no choice. Well, it's fun in math. So it turns out there's six different ways to do that. Right? You could go blue, green, yellow. Right? You could go blue, green, yellow. Or you could go, you could swap those two around. So you could go blue, yellow, green. Or you might decide to put the green first, so you could do green, blue, yellow. Or you might decide to swap the latter two around there, so you might go green, yellow, blue. Or what other permutation or arrangement is there? You might go, start with yellow, we'll put it at the front, so you might go yellow, blue, green. Or you might go yellow, green, blue. I think we covered everything. Looks to me like there's six there. Yeah, there is. So you don't want to do it that way. No, that would be annoying. You probably want to learn how to count. And you thought you knew how to count. Philly Webbit. Okay, how about Lotto 649? All right, used to be illegal to gamble in Canada. They would even take your lottery ticket from you at the border if you had one. Now it's kind of like a business for the government. All right, so there you go. They put all these balls in this big plexiglass thing, 49 numbered balls, and then they spin it, and the balls come rolling out, and you just want your six numbers to come out. All right, so six numbers. How many choices do you have for the first number? Let's see. The first number comes out. How many choices are there? How about 49? So one ball's out. Now there's 48 left. Then there's 47. Then there's 46 balls left. Then they pick another one out of the 45 that are left, and then there's 44 left, and they pick one of those. So it turns out there's that many multiplied all together. It ends up being something like 10 billion or something like that. All right, so it ends up being 10 billion ways to do it. Right, 1.06 times 10 to the 10th. If you do that, multiply it out, it's 10 billion possible ways to arrange those balls in some order. Turns out it's not quite that bad. It's only 14 million because you don't care about the order. But we'll talk about that later. So we're going to be learning how to count. You didn't know that you could count that high, did you? Next slide, sinusoidal functions. Used to be called trigonometric... it used to be called periodic functions. So we're going to look at things that have periods, things that have a cycle to them, things that, go up and down and repeat themselves. How about the amount of sunlight you get? How about the temperature in, it gets hot in the summer and cold in the winter. You ever noticed hot in the summer, cold in the winter? Right? Things that have a period and a cycle to them. Right? So instead of y equals x squared plus 4x, like we did in grade 11, you're going to look at things that say y equals 3 sine theta plus 4. Ooh, even fancier. And notice they got lots of humps, not just one hump. And, of course, you'll learn how to do regressions with them. Remember doing regressions? You're going to do regressions all over again. How about design and measurement? Everybody's favorite. Say your auntie says, I want you to build me a patio. So there's my backyard. And she wants her patio a little, because I just built a patio last summer. So I actually did all this math. So you're going to brick in the patio. I like bricks. So you get 12 by 8, so a 12-foot by 8-foot patio. And let's see, that's going to be 96 square feet of patio. And how big is a brick? Well, let's see, each brick is, they're 8 inches by 4 inches, at least the ones I had were. So 8 inches by 4 inches, so let's see, how many bricks am I going to need? How many 8 by 4 inch bricks? That's 32 square inches, but 1 square foot is 144 square inches, so 32, 144, 6... So that, oh man, it's going to be a little bit of math there. So you got to calculate how many bricks you need. And then, of course, you don't just throw the bricks in the mud. You've got to actually throw some gravel down first. And that's like $4.99 a cubic yard. And you got to throw some sand down as well. So that's like $3.55 a cubic yard. So you got to buy some gravel, some sand. You got to pay somebody with a backhoe to dig it all out. Because you're not going to dig it with a shovel, are you? Although I did. Yeah, I dug it out by hand. Nothing else to do. Great summer. Anyway, so you're going to calculate how much it costs to build that patio. Lots of math there, and volumes, and surface areas, and money, and taxes. Woo-hoo, you're going to love it. We'll do about five of those things. Right. Research project. Okay, we're supposed to do a research project in grade 12 of some sort. I'm not sure what to do. I'm leaning towards a game day. You'll invent a probability game, and I hesitate to call it gambling, but we'll invent some game where, you know, a beanbag toss, and you'll invent it for your project. And certain scores will have certain outcomes, and you'll calculate the probability of winning this game, and stuff like that, and the payoff, and oh, it'll be good. All right, so that might be what we do, I'm not sure. It's all new. It's a new project thing. All right, let's start with our notes. Probability notes, let's go. All right, so read the notes. There's what they look like. I'm not going to read them to you. There's how you calculate probability. Next slide. So to calculate probability, you calculate the number of favorable trials, the number of favorable things that happen, compared to the number of total trials you did. And by the way, if you go to the Downs in the summer when they got the racetrack, they got the bouncy structure for the kids. It's all free. The petting zoo. They got, oh, it's just a nice day out with the kids. But don't gamble. Just spend the $2 on a horse. That's fine. $2. But, right, it's a cheap day out and lots of free stuff. And it's just nice and warm there, out of the wind. Anyway, it turns out the odds are slightly different. Right, probability is the total number of what you want divided by all the possibilities, whereas odds is the total number of what you want divided by the total number of what you don't want. So it turns out that odds and probability are sort of the same thing. You can convert back and forth. All right. Well, I hope everybody knows how to do these. I hope you know how to convert percentages to decimals and to fractions. If not, I would suggest you learn how to use that fraction button on your calculator. Hang out with me and I'll show you how to use your calculator, even though you should know how to use your calculator. Okay, so 0.1 is 10%. 1 out of 10 is the same as 10 out of 100. We'll just fill these in. 9 out of 52 is 0.173 approximately, or 17.3%. Learn how to use that ABC button on your calculator. If you really can't do fractions, I don't care. It's a little late to be teaching you that now. So 0.75 really means 75 one-hundredths. In fact, that's how you're supposed to say it. So we can knock out the quarters there. Greatest common factor. Sounds like 3/4 to me. So turning it into a fraction is 3/4. Guess what 1 is? Well, you could turn 1 into a fraction, 1 over 1. That'd be kind of silly. How about 0.95? Well, that's really called 95 one-hundredths if you say it properly, isn't it? That's what Earth people do. They make a decimal because they're too lazy to divide by 100. And then I could factor out some nickels there. Greatest common factor of a nickel. 19/20. I'm thinking that'd be the fraction, the reduced proper fraction. And then I could turn it into a decimal, or percentage rather, because 95 out of 100 is French for 95%. How about 35%? That's really 35 per 100. That's how the French people say it. That's right. So it's 0.35 if you know how to do decimals, and it's also the same as 35%. Right. That's why you call it percent, because it's per 100. 100 is French for cent, or the other way around. Okay, and then this one is learn how to use your calculator. Turns out this will be about 18%. Right here. And believe it or not, 0.16666666666666 is 1/6. All right, button on your calculator will tell you that. All right, you can read this. 3, 2, 1, engage. You can read this, right? But I hope you know that all percentages go from 0 to 100. You can't have 110%. You can't have 150%. Not in probability. You can't have a negative percent. You know, like. That just doesn't make sense. So all your numbers are going to be between 0 and 1, or 0 and 100%, or 0 and 1.00. All right, so let's learn about this complement thing. If there's a 90% chance you will pass grade 12, what's the probability you will not pass? So we put the little bar on top, not pass. So the probability you won't pass, the probability of passing is 90%. So the probability of not passing, which is how we do it, like the boom, like that. See, we put that bar over top. That means not passing is going to be, well, it's going to be 100% less the 90% chance that you do pass. Right? So the probability of not passing is 100% less the probability that you do pass, because the opposite of passing is not passing. So if the probability of rain, the probability of no rain is 3/5, wouldn't that mean the probability of some rain is 1 minus 3/5? So 2/5. Or you could call this 60% and 40%. In any event, it's got to add up to be 100. That's what you call probability. Remember, this was in the Sun one year, the headlines. There was actually a headline one winter, that one fall, that said there's a 35% chance of a cold winter. And most teachers are going, what the heck does that mean? Doesn't that mean there's a 65% chance of a warm winter? Well, at least not a cold winter. Why would you write a headline that said that? That was really weird. All right, let's do our experiment here. So you're going to toss your cups. You're going to come up with a tally, and then you'll total up the tallies. So you're going to do, I broke up into about 4 different teams, and each team was going to do one experiment of flipping 50 cups. So each time you flip a cup, it's called a trial. You're going to take each of those trials and record whether it landed on the base, on the side, or on the rim, on the top of the cup. All right, and then we'll tally it up and calculate the percentage. And here was the results. You ready? Here we go. So Cassie and Harry had a team, and Darcy's team, and Bobby's team, and Mel had a team. And here's the results we had. Everybody did 50 trials in their experiment. Experiment 1, there you go. I like 50 because I can convert that to a percent really easily. Notice that, coming up on the side seems to be most people had sort of the same numbers, 74, 76, 74. Here was a slightly rogue outlier answer, but I bet you if we did a statistical analysis on that, on a normal distribution, remember that standard deviation stuff, 68% of the time, all that stuff we did in grade 11, I'll bet you that falls within the 68% confidence level. Whatever, we'll check it out some other day. But so those all seem reasonable, right? Notice although there are 4 separate experiments, they all came up with sort of the same thing. So we're actually doing experimental probability. It's fun doing experimental probability. All right, so there's where we ended. Let's just start on, well, we'll finish the notes there. We're starting on an assignment, all right? So I want to see you actually show your work when you do these. This bit about just copying out the answer and handing it in, that's not going to cut it in grade 12. All right, so you're going to solve these problems and make sure you actually read the instructions and then complete the puzzle, please. All right? A lot of you don't read the instructions and you don't complete the puzzle, and I'm not going to go and check to see if you did the right answer. I will now, won't I? So the probability of getting a vowel, well, let's see. On the spinner, there's 8 possibilities. They're all the same size wedge, so they're all the same probability. And how many of them are vowels? Well, let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So there's 5 things that we're favoring, vowels, out of a total of 8. So 5/8. So I'm thinking the probability would be 5/8. So I cross out that letter. What's the probability of a consonant? Well, isn't it going to be the complement of that? Right, 5/8. What's 1 - 5/8? So it's got to be 3/8 left over that aren't vowels, because things that aren't vowels are consonants. What's the probability of getting a Q? Well, how many Q's are on there? 1. 1 out of 8. So there's 1 Q, 1 out of 8. So there's the type of thing we're doing. You can do that as well as I can. Right, so just watch that unfold. So you can use probability to predict outcomes. Once you know the probability of something, you can do it a whole bunch of times, and you can figure out how many times we'll succeed. Right, so here you go. Let's try this. If you know that you get 1 bullseye for every 9 darts, then if you throw 180 darts, how many bullseyes will you get? So now that you know the probability for 9 darts, you can figure out the probability or the payoff for 180 darts. And can you see that it's going to be 20? Remember how to do some cross-multiplying, some solving proportions, pop that little beast up to there, isolate the X, lazy algebra, bada-bing, bada-boom, not 20. Turns out 20. So if you get 1 bull every time you throw 9 darts, you should get 20 bullseyes every time you throw 180 darts. Pretty complicated math. Eh? If you spin the spinner 400 times, how many times would you expect it to stop on a vowel? Well, didn't we calculate that it was 5 vowels for every 8 spins? So that would be how many vowels for 400 spins? Let me see. I'm thinking that's 50 times greater, so that should be 50 times greater. Right? If there's 5 girls for every 8 boys, how many girls are there for 400 boys? Yep, a little bit of fancy algebra there. Sounds like about 250. Yep, so we were good. And how about for the letter N? Well, there was only 1 N, so that's a... How many N's would you expect? Well, if it's 1 for every 8, and you spin 400 times, shouldn't you expect 50? So that's called solving proportions. That's kind of several grades ago, let's put it that way. And we did lots of that in grade 11 as well, especially in the unit B. How about if you roll a regular 6-sided die 1,200 times? How many times would you expect? It doesn't mean you will get exactly that, but you can expect to get close to that particular many events that are successful of rolling a 5. So how many times should you roll a 5? Well, let's see, 1 out of 6. So 1 out of every 6 rolls, provided you didn't doctor the dice with some lead weights, you know. So if you roll 1,200 times, well, holy smoke, you should get about 200, shouldn't you? Sure. All right, so there you go. There's pretty basic math, knowing how to calculate a probability and then use that to calculate your expected value for any number of rolls. All right, this was a tricky one. All right, turns out that, read this question. All right, we saw the movie on this, the Bill Nye movie. So if you flip 10 heads in a row, I mean, come on, it's got to be a tail the next time, doesn't it? Well, it turns out that's not true. It turns out that even though you flip 10 heads in a row, you could still, it's still a 50-50 chance you'll flip a head again. When you're flipping a random coin, it doesn't care what happened the 10 times before, it's still a 50-50 toss. That's amazing, eh? It is possible to have 10 girls in a row if you're making babies. Not very likely, but it is possible. Let's keep going with the puzzle. So if 16 out of every 200, right, maybe you're doing the quality assurance job at a particular factory. That's big bucks. If you know how to do statistics, you can get a quality assurance job. That's what we're talking about in statistics. So if you do a sample of 200 toys and you find 16 are knackered, or broken rather, you'd say, well, that was a 16 out of, that's 8 of 100. You'd say that's an 8% failure. 8% are defective, which means, duh, 92% are not defective, because doesn't it have to add up to 100? All right. And then if somebody says, so, if we know that 8 for every 100 are defective, then if we make 1,500 toys this week, how many will be defective? So it's got to be the same proportion. Do a little bit of fancy math. So you can expect to have 120 people emailing you, telling you that your toys suck because you got an 8% failure rate. Right. So that's called calculating experimental probability and then applying it to find out what you expect for any particular sample size or production level or what have you. Next slide. Oh, yeah, so there you go. That's it. Make sure you check out the ABC button for the folks that don't like the fractions that we're doing. You might want to learn how to use your calculator. I'm not going to show you how unless you come and show me, because every calculator is different. All right. So get familiar with the calculator. Hang out with me for a few minutes when I let folks go a touch early, because that's probably when you do your best learning. One-on-one. There you go. Briefing complete.